Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am joined this week with the young scrapper, Grapzilla himself, Bradley Poole. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Hello. Thank you for having me.
No bothers. So, if anyone's watching the video feed, which you all should, you get some extra Easter eggs from there, especially the Talon Junior episode, which is my particular favourite intro so far. You can see that, Bradley has his emblem behind him. Is that on a t-shirt?
No. That is coming out on a t-shirt next week, hopefully. Limited stock, but excellent. I can always order more, you know.
We'll do the merch plugs towards the end with your social media. But we'll go for the usual questions. This is your first podcast. I am, for lack of a better term, taking your podcast cherry. And how did you get into pro wrestling?
Pretty much. It's kind of a boring story, to be honest. I've been mates with Ian Skinner for a long, long time. He actually stayed up in the Elgin for a while and did a bit of MMA training with me. Then pretty much I just saw an Instagram picture of him doing his debut and literally just messaged him saying, how do I do this? Told me where it was. Went through the Glasgow for my first training session, and since then just loved it and just kept doing it ever since.
So were you a fan beforehand?
Started off as a fan, yeah. Yeah. I was always, even through my MMA journey, I've always been a fan of wrestling. I always wanted to do it, even when I was like training in other sports and all that stuff, but I just couldn't find anywhere up here to do it at all.
Yeah. So what did you start watching? You said you were 23 before it went on, so that's probably, I don't know, earliest memories possibly being 2002 draft time, around about then?
Earliest memory I've got in my head, and I always remember it. I remember I was sitting watching it with my dad, and it was Big Show and Taker walking down that SmackDown ramp when they were a team. That's the earliest memory I can remember from wrestling, the earliest one.
That is super early then, because that's what, 99, something like that. That was, I'm very surprised. I thought you must be like two, something like that.
That's the furthest back I can think about my wrestling memory. I remember Big Show and Taker walking down the ramp. So since then, I don't think I've ever not watched it, to be honest.
So who were your favourites growing up?
That's a tough one. Probably the top three I remember always watching, because my dad used to watch it with me. He wasn't the biggest fan, but he just watched his sort of people was interested in. So I think the top three I remember watching with him was probably Stone Cold, bit of Shamrock and Kurt Angle.
That's quite a mix, and that actually makes sense for what you have went on to do yourself. That Shamrock and Angle especially are in there.
Yeah, they're quite iconic for me.
Yeah, I'm right about the kind of same with my mum. More, she would sit in and watch, and pretty much I think she liked Triple H, so she would sit and watch Triple H, and wasn't that fussed for everything else. It was like, what's Triple H doing, or what's Grandmaster Sexy doing?
Oh, that was you.
So what she always remembers, and I don't know why, it's always the one she remembers, Grandmaster Sexy. And the weirdness. Anyway, so that's... I was expecting it to be further along, like, Ruthless Aggression era. I wasn't expecting it to be the attitude you'd be where you're watching.
Not expecting it that far, but...
No, not at all. So you mentioned
2003 as well. 2003 when Goldberg came to WWE to face the Rock. Dad was a massive Goldberg fan as well, so we had to watch every Goldberg match that was on.
I know, it took about 10 minutes in total.
So I didn't take up much of my time, though, not at all.
So you mentioned Ian Skinner, of course, a past guest on our show, that... It was up in Elgin, of course. This is where SWN Towers, our studio, is based. So you're Elgin-based?
Elgin-based. Lived here for... Went to school here. Stayed here since I was like 4 or 5. So originally from down south, but no, pretty much Elgin. Elgin bred.
I'm not. I'm Rothus.
You're Rothus?
Rothus, yeah. So it's a bit rougher.
No. A bit more life in Elgin.
There's a bit more life. I mean, there's life in Rothes. It's just you don't want to go near any of it. So
you don't want to go near it. No.
So Elgin based. So you trained. Well, Ian Skinner, of course, was down in Airdrie Barhead. So that's a fair bit of travelling.
Yeah, about 4 hours each way, about that roughly. I'm up at 6 a.m. every, well, when it was on, every Sunday I was up at 6 in the morning to get there.
So did you just go once a week, or was, did you do, like, just go for the weekend and do a couple of training sessions a week? What was your
schedule? It was train there every Sunday, but I've got, a sponsored athlete at Fitison, the gym in Elgin. So I train with Doug Nevins, who's a Commonwealth amateur wrestler, so I'm able to get a lot of grappling while he's training with him as well, and can still do striking with him and everything. So I'm able to train all aspects still, even though I stay quite far away from it. It's very handy having all this basically in my hands just to make use of it all.
Absolutely. So I think I'm not very familiar with things like MMA and all that kind of stuff. So is that did you start with that before you moved going to wrestling, or what was your kind of starting point?
Starting point was boxing, because Dad was a boxer in the RAF, so it started off with that. I liked watching it, but I just didn't enjoy it that much. Then started mixed martial arts, fell in love with grappling more than the striking wise of it. The jiu-jitsu and wrestling side of it was great. Just loved doing that. Then started, like, once I found out I could manage to do wrestling, just for the travel wise and that, then I kind of just, I wouldn't say faded away from MMA, but more like focused on pro wrestling. Still got my sessions in each week with the mixed martial arts and that, but now it's mostly just focused on pro wrestling, and just that's the main aspect of it right now.
So yeah, so you can definitely see the evolution there. Start with the boxing, like the athleticism, then MMA, of course, you like the grappling bit. Pro wrestling seems to kind of have that kind of mix of the two, the showmanship of the likes of boxing and the grappling of MMA as well. So you didn't like watching boxing, was a bit boring. It's a lot of hugging, really, until they actually punch each other.
It's all right. It's just, there's a lot of politics in every sport. Then that's just, you look, I don't know how to explain it, really. Just, I knew I just always wanted to be a wrestler, but I just couldn't ever, I had to just settle for the second best, basically. Okay. That's what it was more than anything, I think.
You just wanted to throw folk about, was kind of the,
literally, I just wanted to pick people up and chuck them.
That actually leads up, when I put out your photo saying I was going to have an interview with you, I think there's a lot of your fellow trainee colleagues just giving me like little bits of snippets of your training method, which seems to be throwing. So I'll just go through the list.
It works really well.
Let's go through the list right from the start. So we'll start with Rain. She put, ask him about his chin splitting my head open.
That's a golden oldie, that one. That's from when I first started, really. That was I was just doing a sort of sequence with Rain, and she hit me with a spine buster on the way down for some reason. She like headbutted my chin. I don't know if it was a tactic of hers or not, but because I'm hard as nails, I've got this rock solid iron chin going on here, and then she took most of the brunt and got a head split from it.
So we've got Una Raw, ask about the time I flung him about at training.
Yeah, I underestimated Una Raw's judo ability. Turns out I didn't know this, he's a brown belt in judo. And once he kind of got a hold of my arm one day in a match, I went for a trip. I think it was 4 in a row judo flips I got. And I managed to regain myself. I was like, oh, you're Grapzilla, you're fine. Then once I got hold of him, I showed him the ways how to do it properly enough.
But I bet he reminds you of those first four throws at any opportunity.
Oh, yeah, but he definitely let me know. He knows how to fling people about also. He does.
I've got Tom Humphreys, who writes our Future Shock articles. Ask him about the time Ewan kicked me in the face at training. What's happening at these training sessions?
It was great. I say that was in Tom's, that one. Ewan was showing us a little flip movement he was doing. And Tom's very good of just showing up out of nowhere. You turn around and you're like, oh, there's Tom. Loving the bits he's selling, but like, Tom was just there in the wrong place at the wrong time as Ewan flipped, and just his foot just crapped Tom right in the nose. But we're like all still mates, it was all good.
It's like the butler in Mr. Deeds. I don't know if you've ever seen Mr. Deeds, but it's just the
Piers. I don't think I have, no.
It's an Adam Sandler film. It's a good Adam Sandler film, which is rare, but it is a good one. It's worth watching. We've got Actually, I'll leave the SWA one for a little bit later. I'll just finish just now with Jason Hyde, who would have been interviewed last week in our chronological, in our schedule. And he said, ask him if he misses me, and if he says no, pass judgment on him.
Oh, I guess everyone must have a soft spot for Jason Hyde somehow, though.
I know, for better or for worse.
He knocked me out of the PWS Rumble by pure fluke, so I'll have to get him back for that one. Definitely wasn't by his talent.
I think that counts as you missing him, so I don't have to pass judgment on you, so I think that's
no judgment here. No.
So we'll go back to the wrestling, more wrestling bit. So mm-hmm. When was your debut? So it must be shortly, was tail end of last year, was it? Or
tail end of last year, yeah.
And was it in a rumble or was it one of the showcase like tag matches?
It was just a little match, but it wasn't the best one. The best one I had was the one with Krieger. Count that as my true proper singles debut.
Okay, what was your thoughts going into that first match or that match with Krieger, whichever you consider to be your first?
The one with Krieger was definitely the first one. No, that was a. I guess I was nervous for it because it was something different, but at the same time, it was just, I think it was more excited nerves more than anything. I basically couldn't wait to get in and just show everyone what I could do more than anything.
So it was like being a friend, I'm assuming it's more of a kids crowd. So what was it like being showcased in front of this brand new audience?
Oh, it was, when it was in there, I don't really know how to explain the feeling. I was enjoying every moment of it and just, like it felt like I was in there for 5 minutes. Like it didn't feel very long, but at the same time, I felt like I did loads and loads when I look back at it. But like I was just, I don't know, it's just something I always wanted to do, and I finally got to do it. Like I dreamed about wrestling for ages, and I managed to get in there, get someone like Krieger, big name, and just got to go show that I could fit in there.
Absolutely. Did he have a hand in your training? Was it himself and TJ Rage or?
Yeah, Krieger and TJ Rage, they've definitely like helped me get to where I'm at. Really great coaches. Recommend them a lot. They're really good. They just sort of, they can look at you and just know exactly what you need to do pretty much.
So how long was it from your training, your first training session, going 3 hours down the road, 3 hours back, to you actually making your debut?
I think I started in 2018. I'm pretty sure I started in February 2018 or something like that. Then the debut was, I think it was July the 5th, 2019, I'm pretty certain.
All right, so just pretty sure that seems to be kind of the standard. I'm finding that's just kind of standard. Mm-hmm. You'll start approaching shows.
It was just over a year, I'm pretty certain, yeah.
So, of course, you've appeared in the SWA Battlezone. Is that... Am I right in thinking that? I know it was SWA. You've appeared at
the Lions Den. That's what it was
Lions.
Called.
Oh, that's what they call it. That Lions was the one. Was that your debut for SWA?
That was my SWA debut, yeah.
All right, so that's our question from Ian Skinner. He said, ask him about your debut for SWA.
Yeah, it was. That was another one I was really nervous for. And me and Skinner were backstage just waiting for the numbers. And I seen I was coming up and I was like, oh, I'm nervous. What should I do, mate? And basically, Skinner just turned around to me and said, just go out there and scrap. So the music hit. I was like, that's a good idea. Just went out and started flinging my legs about, kicking anyone. I could see the legs just aimed and took fire. Anyone that was in the way was just taking a kick.
So growing up with Ian, so was Ian would be like, other than watching wrestling with your dad, were you watching it with Ian Skinner as well? Was that kind of your thing?
I wouldn't say it was more Skinner for me. It was just the start with it was just an MMA training buddy. I only ever seen him in the gym. Like, I'm more friends with him now than when I started wrestling or was when he was living in Elgin. But I just sort of reached out to him because it was someone I knew that did it.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, he was just sort of the one like I stuck to when I first joined, like started training. He was one that made me feel more like comfortable there, and if that makes sense. And he spent a lot of time like helping me fit in with the crowd and all that stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. It's always, I mean, I've never done the training myself. I don't think I ever would, but it's fine to have someone at least you know. So it builds that kind of trust quite quickly. So you know that if you can go up to him and go, I want to try this, he's more than likely going to go, All right.
Yeah, literally, he's always down to help anyone and just say you want to try something straight away, he'll be straight into it.
Absolutely. So that travelling, was it by bus, train, just anything? Plane, train, automobile?
By car. I don't think the train would be the one. I was looking at train times and it was just ridiculous. We got to do about 7 stops on the way and all that stuff in different places and switch over. It wasn't for me, so... No, it was just park up the car every morning, fill me with coffee and fill the car with petrol, and off I went.
Okay, I obviously could not manage doing that. I used to work near Aberdeen in Blackburn, and it was like an hour and a half drive every day, and I was like, I can't do this. An hour and a half one way and then an hour and a half back. So that's just your one journey. And then you've got to actually do some...
I've got to hit the gym, I've got to train, I've got to do it all. I've got to do the drive all over again.
And then just sit my arse for 8 hours and then think, oh, God, drive back. But
Sunday's a rest day. It's not. Sunday's not a rest day in my eyes.
So do you do... I'm not going to ask what's your job, but you must have a full-time job as well with that. So
yeah, I work full-time as well.
How do you manage to fit everything in? You just no sleep?
My hours are good. My hours, I start very early, then finish reasonably, like, good in the afternoon, decent timing, and weekends are always off. It's basically just... I just make time for everything, if it makes sense. Just, I don't... Like, you'll never catch me in a pub that often. I've not got time to go do that sort of stuff. And I'll either be too busy training or either travelling to do something.
So it's... Especially, I mean, I suppose when it's something that's your passion, you'll just find time, I suppose.
I've always got time for wrestling all the time. Always got time for it.
So with the things like crossover, of course, you mentioned Ken Shamrock, Kurt Angle earlier as some of your early favourites. Brock Lesnar, I'm assuming that was one that...
Ah, who doesn't like Lesnar? How can you not like a man like that?
is there any thoughts about maybe doing a little bit of both? I mean, you did MMA training, but you preferred to do the wrestling and then went to do pro wrestling. Is there any inclination to try and do both?
Not for myself, no. It's... For me, I was more a sparring partner and I preferred the grappling-wise, tournament-wise. I don't know. I don't think getting... Some of them people that get in that case just animals. I don't think I'm at that stage yet.
So you prefer to tie someone up than actually just getting punched in the face?
Pretty much.
that's fair. That's fair. I'm not going to...
I look at the grappling side of it, it's more impressive in my mind, like how you can just... technique to get hold of someone, just put them down without them even managing to stop you, pretty much. It's just an art.
Absolutely. So you started in July 19, you said your debut was. As you can see by this podcast, there is no structure. I'm just picking things off as I go on.
That's fine.
You said you started in July 19. So how many matches did you have before, of course, the doomsday of COVID hit?
I think it was 3 or 4, not many. I'm still quite new to the scene.
So is it just mainly your training schools, shows, and PWS, and of course the SWA one? So is there any companies that you've got your eye on once the shows start up again?
I don't know if I've got any eyes on anyone in particular. I think it's more I just want to get out there and show everyone, if that makes sense. Like, I'm not picky who it is or that. I'm just, as many opportunities as I can possibly get, I'm just going to try and pile them all up and just be as busy as I possibly can.
Is that the same for opponents? Or is,
no, that's the right way to answer the question. I don't know if it was a good answer or not.
No, absolutely. It's the same for opponents, unless you're just, are you hell-bent on getting a hold of you know, Raw and Ring or Ian Skinner or anyone that's like, I have to face him soon?
I think I need to show Jason Hyde and Euro Raw their place, but at the same time, I'm the scrapper. Anyone and anywhere, anytime, any place. I'm always looking for a scrap, always looking for a fight. Just love getting in there. I just love the combat side of it.
So you say, yeah, you love the combat side of it. Did you find the actual showmanship side of it a bit more difficult out of the two then? Or did, like, say, you went out there and it kind of was like, oh, I'm wrestling now, this is what I do?
Showmanship, funnily enough, it kind of, in a way, it was similar, I guess. I'm trying to think how I can say it similar. Like, it's just everyone's there to do their own thing. Same when you walk into a grappling tournament, everyone's there just to put on their best show, get the result and go home. And I kind of feel like, in a way, that is what it's like when you go into a wrestling ring as well. At the same time, when you see everyone, it's just the showmanship is the same. Everyone's there; they're wanting to put on a show, show everybody what they can do, then go home. Really, at the end of the day,
as long as you get the reaction that you've aimed
exactly
for round about the start, then you're quite happy with what you get from it.
Just want everyone to enjoy it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, as long as that's pretty much the end goal of any wrestling, isn't it? As long as people enjoy it, then really you can't go wrong, regardless of what happens actually. Then as long as everyone's kind of safe at the end. Was there a difficulty like doing things like pulling punches or anything like that? But you're a grappler, so that really wasn't that much of a difference for you.
I was getting used to the strikes and that a bit, I guess. But the grappling side of it, I feel like, I don't know if I'm trying to sound cocky here or not, but I feel like I managed to get into the grappling side of it quite, I wouldn't say easy, but it kind of came natural, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, grappling wise, it was very similar. It's a lot of the same holds, everything's very similar.
Yeah, so it's, like I said, I was expecting, when I was seeing you did like MMA background, I'm thinking, right, okay, so that means he punches people a lot, so he must have to stop punching people a lot. But no, like I say, it is very transferable. It's more just a case of doing the fine tuning, which would have been your Sunday training. You do all your cardio and your strength and all that kind of stuff during the week, and then you get your fine tune at the end.
The real training happens on the Sunday.
Yeah. So how was the first bumping then? How was like kind of releasing yourself and
that got a bit getting used to the bumping side of it, because I used to be so used to getting put on the floor. Like, you do anything you possibly can to not go down, then now I've got to learn how to go down, like, just by pure will, basically, like, just whenever you can, pretty much.
I don't know,
I'm not going to explain it, but, like, yes, safety, everything.
But that's always my fear whenever I see, because I have moments in my head and go, oh, I can go to Aberdeen. They did training in Aberdeen. I could do there. That's an hour and a half up the road. That's fine. And then I think, I don't want to fall down. And I don't particularly, I'm 30 now, I don't like standing up quickly, so I don't think I could do that. So I'm just like, no, it's fine, I'll do the podcast. That seems to be a lot safer. I'm in my office room. This is fine. This is a close up.
I'd be telling lies if I wasn't winded after that first bump. I'd be telling a lot of lies if I said that, but I did get a little winded when I took the first one.
Let's see. So we've got traveling, spoke about your debut. One of our special questions that we have on our show, I'm sure if you've listened to them before, is, of course, what is your favourite dinosaur?
Favourite dinosaur? It's got to be a T-Rex, has it?
It's a classic, I suppose, yeah.
It's got to be a T-Rex. Everyone knows a T-Rex.
Big legs, tiny arms.
Exactly. Myself.
People are during this lockdown time, it's hard for folk to actually, like, of course, get their name out there, because there's no wrestling to actually do. So have you found that your social media activity is becoming a bit more regular because of it?
I'd probably say so, yeah. It's pretty much just the only way we've got to advertise ourselves and that, just stay relevant, really, isn't it?
Absolutely, and as of recording, we would have been 2 weeks, 3 weeks out from our Twitter tournament, the Survivor Series, which you were claiming that you were going to do a diss track if you won.
People obviously didn't want it, so
have you got a preview in your head of what you may have been saying to anyone or to Ewan especially?
To Ewan, I feel like it would have been different for whoever it was, but. I don't know. I feel like if I got to that quarter final, I reckon the bars would have been tight. They would have been ready for whoever was getting it. But I feel like I'll just have to keep it dangling on a string just now for when it'll come at its finest.
One day.
We'll see how loud you get on Twitter. If he gets any louder, we might have to just upset him a little bit.
Well, he did throw you four times, so that's just
he did throw me four times. That sounds, I guess, a four-bar diss track might have to work for that.
Absolutely. So where can we find you on likes of social media?
Social, I'm always on my Twitter page, PW/Bradley Poole. Instagram, BradleyPoole123. That's my two main uses of social media. You'll see the boring side of me on Instagram. That's mainly just my days out with the missus, mainly.
And training. I see there's training. A lot of training videos of you.
A lot of training videos on there.
Of you throwing about a big dummy about. obviously, it's not you. So
I'll just stick you in space on that, to be fair. It might get me a bit more motivated for training.
So how does your other half feel about you, like, just trying to fit her in to that as well, into that? Or she been with you that long that she's kind of used to you training?
She's been with me through the most of it, yeah. She was pretty much with me when I first started it, and she's helped me all the whole way. She's the one that designs my logos. She's one of my sponsors, Illustrate. She's on Twitter as well. She does, like, my Grapzilla design in the background there. That was all her. Right. Got another one getting done just now by her. No, she really helps me a long way, especially with the, like, social side of it as well.
That's fine. Lisa's fine. Lisa, like, she's probably after days of you coming in, sweating, training, that, she's probably like, go down the road for Sunday. Just give me some peace.
Get rid of me for a day. I know she's probably desperate for it to start up again. Get rid of me.
So you, like I said, by your social media, it's very clear that you are still keeping yourself very busy. It's just getting that. Mm-hmm. That last little bit of the actual wrestling, pro wrestling.
Exactly. That's the bit everyone's waiting for.
So plans for the future, we already mentioned you just want to get anywhere, you want to face anyone.
Anywhere.
What's your main goal? Is it WWE? Is it Japan? I would take you as a Japan kind of guy.
Main goal? I've always said Japan would be the main one. I feel like it would suit my style, but I guess it would be. I feel like just saying getting on television is the main goal to start with. Just I'd love to see myself on the television, pretty much doing it. Like, I don't know if that's a boring goal compared to most people, but I don't know. It's just something I always think that'd be cool, just looking up there and see myself on it.
It's definitely one of those doable ones. It's definitely one you can go, well, even if I'm getting thrown about for a minute by Dave Mastiff on NXT UK, at least I've ticked that one off. Next one, I can see where I can go from there.
I feel like he could throw me about a lot easier than I could throw him about, to be fair. So,
yeah, he's a bit bigger. He's a bit bigger.
A bit bigger than me.
I mean, Krieger is kind of like a stretched out. He's taller, but he's probably about the same kind of size. So, you never know.
Krieger was taller than me, and I still managed to show him some airtime. So, you never know. Exactly.
Just thinking of opponents that I think, that, I mean, obviously you're going to say you'll face anyone that I mention anyway, but I'm thinking of a grappler, throwing guys about, yourself, Andy Wild. I see that as a kind of...
That'd be a good matchup.
That's a guy that possibly... Is there any... I mean, the only training school at the moment that I know is open as of recording is FPWA. So is there a thought of getting down there for a session?
I've been thinking about it just now. Once the timing's a bit better, pretty much, and just... Got to see if I'm still able to travel down there and do it, because I don't know what their travel restrictions are on that just now, but I'm thinking about hitting them up soon and just get some training back in soon. It'd be good to train with someone different as well, especially Andy Wild at his school. It'd be good to meet up with him as well, maybe get a connection or something going on. It'd be good.
Absolutely.
I'm always out for meeting new people.
Yeah, and throwing them. So I'm very proud of myself before we go that I didn't do your introduction saying swimming and talent because of your name, but I thought I'd mention it at the end because I said it to my wife before she left for the day. I went, I've got this cracker of a line. I'm going to say, young scrapper, Grapzilla, swimming and talent, Bradley Poole, and she went, dinner.
Just it would have played a blinder, to be fair. I'm happy for out there. You couldn't let that one go to waste.
I had to at least tell you about it before we go. Hopefully we'll next time. Hopefully when this goes out, we'll have a bit more. We'll know what's happening. We'll actually be maybe not shows. Shows will be next year, but at least we'll know what's happening with training again, restrictions and that. But I don't want to keep you all day. I just want to chat with you, at least find out a bit more about Bradley Poole. we usually speak about TV shows and that as well, but as I said, at 23 and you spend all your time throwing things about, does TV have a lot of time in your life?
Oh, everyone's got a bit of time for the telly, haven't they?
What's your binge then?
My binge? I don't think what I've recently just binged. Gangs of London was a good one I've recently binged. I'd recommend anyone to try that. Peaky Blinders, that's another one. Anything that's brought heavy gangster, that sort of stuff, I love all that sort of thing.
Right, okay, so I'll put that in the recommendation pile. Same with...
Recommendation film-wise, if you've not seen The Gentleman, if you've not seen the Gentleman, then you need to get that change. That's one everyone I recommend, they need to see that one.
So at the moment, I'm always at a stage where I sit down and go, right, I need to watch something. I don't watch something I need to pay attention to.
Yeah.
I watched Brooklyn Nine-Nine that I've seen a million times. So
everyone's likes a bit of Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
That's right, I'm my go-to at the moment. But anyway, yeah, so I won't keep you all day. We'll kind of have a wee wrap-up. But it's nice to speak to someone that actually lives nearby.
I know, I thought I was the only one, but it's good to see there's another person out there from here that loves the wrestling.
There's a few, far, no one will admit it. No one, there's a few t-shirts I see when I'm going up the street. I'm like, wrestling fan. And I go, I don't want to admit it to you. I don't want to
admit
it. that's the biggest problem. It's like, you see them and it's usually like a humongous guy wearing a t-shirt. And go, I want to say, yeah, I'm a wrestling fan, but I don't want to speak to you particularly. So I'm going to have to just keep it on the down low for the moment. Just...
Oh, but no, all I ever get at work is, do you know Grado? That's the only one I ever get asked at work, do you know Grado? It's the only one.
Well, maybe one day. Have you actually, do you know Grado?
I've shook his hand, I'll say that's as much.
Well, I mean, it's close enough.
You
can say you do. But yeah, I've tried to wrap this up three times and then some pops into my head, so we'll do it this time. So one more time, if you just plug your social media, where can we get your cool t-shirts from?
My social media on my Twitter is PW/BradleyPoole. And my Instagram's BradleyPoole123. But I'm always on both of those. That's my main socials you'll catch me on. I'll mostly be on it with just promoting myself, promoting my sponsorships, Fitison, the gym, promoting them, promoting Illustrate, and promoting all her stuff as well. That's mostly where you'll find me social-wise.
And that's Twitter's where the main people one. Can grab you for your Grapzilla tease. I think we reviewed it a couple of days ago, so which are looking awesome. Anyway, yeah, thank you very much for joining us.
That's fine. Thank you very much for having me.